That would work.
And I was completely correct in this way. I went from that situation to a New York gallery where a collector would come in and say, can you hold this for 2 weeks? And I would say, and very honestly, I can't hold it for an hour. I mean, if you want it, buy it now. And if you don't want it, come in again. Whatever. We'll see you.
Thank you.
I was completely correct, because in 10 minutes' time, somebody would, I mean, the traffic pattern was so much more fierce, you know, that this idea of holding something so that the collector, you want to take it for the evening, fine, you can always do that.
Yeah.
But for me to hold it over a week or two or three in New York, unheard of. Yeah. Unheard of.
It would.
I mean, go look at a Jasper, you know, when Leo's around and say, can you hold it for 2 weeks? Yeah. Leo would laugh at me. Yeah. Why? Because there were 10 people lined up coming in, including museums. Whoops.
Well, it was at that moment that the Blum dictum appeared in press, which said, living in Los Angeles is like sinking into a warm bowl
of farina. That's right.
There was an interesting precedent for that, because Bill Copley in the 40s and into the 50s had it in Beverly Hills. I think he sold 2 paintings in the whole time, and he got the ultimate revenge. He had the money, he bought it all. He ended up with one of the great collections.
I'll tell you one thing that he did. He had a Cornell show. He had maybe 40 boxes, sold none of them, bought them, sent the money to Joseph, gave them away as Christmas presents. I walk into a thrift store on Santa Monica Boulevard next to Nick Wilder's gallery.
And I told you about it.
And here's this astonishing Cornell box. I said, can I look at that? The guy takes it off the shelf, shows it to me. I said, you know, I like this. What do you ask for it? He said, $60. I said, will you take 50? I buy it for $50, sell it for $12,000. I had 2 fillets and was up front.
Now, listen, there's one thing I wanted to say. When we opened, Betty and I opened our gallery with Morris Lewis, and Andre Emmert came out, and everybody in town vied to give us our opening night dinner, and Eli Brode won.
Right.
And so we were all there at the Brode House. He often does. And we were all there at the Brode House. And a collector, local collector, came up to Aunt Andre and said, my wife and I have always wanted a Morris Lewis. But I guess we really want to come to New York and see what you have.
Yes.
And he said, the best things that I have are here. This is it.
Good for him.
It's the top drawer.
Good for him.
So
good
you won't find, I don't have
it. Did they believe it?
No, I don't
know. I don't think so. I don't think so.
It took more. He was telling me about that. He was so astounded that they're talking to him.
Well, I'll tell you what that attitude did to me, finally, was make me rich. Because I had one show after another, be it Lichtenstein, be it Andy particularly, Jasper, the sculptures in 1960, sold nothing. And I was able painfully, well, there were no money at the time, painfully to put away and to keep for myself and to hang on.
Including, of course, the entire
series. So you're looking today at a man who can easily afford a Bentley. Just tuning it up.
You couldn't find a spark.
I couldn't find my keys.
And what we're doing is going around the room and talking. Each of you started an art business in L.A. Talking about what model the business was founded under. later we'll talk about what you would have considered success at that time, because I think that, but anyway, I think
that, that's very, very good. Correct pronunciation, everybody called it the Heisman Gallery. I was a graduate student at UCLA. I sat down with Walter Hopps and Irving, and we talked about the fact that here was this first generation of artists who actually kind of grew up in L.A., went to school in L.A., and stayed in L.A. Those were the fairest artists. Okay? And there must be another generation behind them. And there was, going to Chouinard at that time, artists like Ed Ruscha and Joe Good and Larry Bell, Ron Meschero, Ed Burriel, and others.
And of course, they were students of some of the...
They were students of a lot of the... yes, people that Irwin taught there, John Copeland's taught there, Al Toon's taught there. A real heyday is what it was. Great creative school. So that was my ambition, to start a gallery that would take that second generation, open across the street from the Ferris Gallery, and kind of make that a continuum. My backers, three young Jewish attorneys, all were very interested in showing Israeli art. They were convinced that if you had an Israeli show in Los Angeles, it would be a smash hit. People would buy a million things, so forth and so on. And I said, all right, we will do an Israeli show, but this is my plan. And we agreed, okay? And they each put in $300 a month, $900 a month to give the support to the gallery necessary. Our rent was $250. We did a couple of exhibitions, opened in December of 1960. A couple of exhibitions, and we had good press, and we actually had a lot of good people come in. I met Ed Jantz, I introduced Ed to you.
That's right.
Then I did the Israeli exhibition, which bombed. I remember two things about it. One, Jewish newspapers coming in and saying that we'll do an article, but it'll cost you $150 to do an article, and if you don't do an article, we'll tell people not to come.
Andrew, on a positive note, you can see that although some very good galleries in the right place, actually they were excellent, Los Angeles wasn't ready for them, but they hung in and made something happen. And the fact that the galleries in due course closed, typically for the fact that the support wasn't there yet, in the size and predictability where we could continue on forever.
Right.
So but at the same,
our period ended, and Los Angeles was left with something to work with.
But question about it, Everett. But at the same time that was going on, the La Cienega Art Box began. And that was a very important aspect of creating a much larger scene. Irving, I know, hated it. Because people dirtied the carpet and stuff.
Well, it became a circuit. They came in with food, you know.
But thousands of people.
But there are all these kind of funny tributaries off of what we're talking about, and I think a major tributary of enormous importance, for me at least, was the Gemini workshop.
I think that's a little later,
but we should talk about it. I mean,
let me finish with 5 minutes. Because the one thing that we did do that, in fact, created, two things I should mention. One, the fact that I did a little exhibition of Joe Good, kind of money bag drawings. We sold 4. I was absolutely delirious and elated that we had sold 4 paintings, probably $150 a piece. Joe came in the next day and was gloomy, as he usually is.
Gloomy.
And I said, aren't you really happy? And he said, no, I said, I really thought I would sell out. And that moment in time, 1960, 61, the beginning of pop art and the other thing they find, artists in New York actually sold out exhibitions. Okay. This is when it began.
That's right.
They began to actually sell out a full exhibition. Well, it didn't happen in our case, but we were delighted. Joe proposed the idea of doing an exhibition called War Babies, artists born about 1935-1936, and that they would show the work. And I said, great, that's fantastic. It was Larry Bell, Ed Burriel, Ron Meschero, and Joe. Ed Ruscha was going to be at the show, but he went off to Europe for his first trip. Jerry McMillan did the poster, which has now become a classic of its own kind, showing the 4 of them sitting around the table, draped with an American flag, with crumbs on it. and Ed Burrell was Ed Burrell, who was black, was eating a watermelon. Larry Bell, who was Jewish, was eating a bagel. Joe Good, who was Catholic, was eating a mackerel. And Ron Miyashiro, who was Japanese, was eating with chopsticks. And as a result of that, the John Birch Society, the big right-wing society, was in process at the time, sent us numerous death threats. And then the left wing got angry at us because you're using these cliche images of all of these guys. But it did two things. It made careers for at least two artists, if not three. One has faltered along the way. Secondly, their name became known within the community, and they prospered in relationship to the other things. Ed then went on to show up Ferris with his
exhibition.
Yeah, well, as did Larry. Right. And Joe Good went on to show Ralph Nelson's and on and on and on.
Yeah.
But the principle is that after that, my backers were distraught. And they decided that they didn't want to do a gallery anymore.
They opened a temple.
All of the controversy was swinging around. And 2 days later, I was asked by Jim Elliott to work at L.A. County Museum.
And you never looked back?
I've never looked back. And I went to the County Museum in June. And my first day, I was there. Bill Sykes, one of the great curators of all time, the Museum of Modern Art, who did the first assemblage exhibition, was out jurying the L.A. local annual exhibition. So my very first day, I spent all day with Bill Sykes, which was incredible. I went to the Wiseman's home that evening. I swam in the pool. I ate Godiva chocolates. And Jim Elliott put his arm around my shoulder and said, "Henry, every day is not going to be like this."
However, welcome to the good life.
That's right.
I mean, before we get to Patio, I think we'll go next. This begins, this sort of flamboyant advertising.
Yeah, right.
Henry and I were talking about this a little bit. I mean, one could think about it starting in LA. I mean, you go on with the
With the boat.
And then, for instance, Edward Chase takes out that ad in Art Forum, In Bed with Two Women
Who Bought It, Farewell
the College Days, which eventually leads to the
Linda
Bengalis.
But Judy Chicago then taking her name in the box.
Henry said something interesting. He mentioned the art of assemblage.
Yes,
The sites worked out.
Yes.
And I remember Dorothy Miller was going around picking pieces for Art of Assemblage.
Yep.
And she came in my gallery. And I had Bruce Beasley sculpture show. Bruce Beasley was at that time 19, a student at Parsons, and I gave him a show because the sculpture was so damn interesting. One piece from that show was in Art of Assemblage, and he was 19 years old.
It made the careers of a number of Los Angeles artists.
Beasley has had a brilliant career, and that was his first show.
The first time out.
19 years old.
Yeah.
Bill Sykes also taught at Princeton, and he was the one who told Dorothy Miller about Frank Stella.
Yeah, that's correct.
And we'll get back to this, but he was one of your principal New York advisors, along with Gelseller.
Bill Sykes, Gelseller, and also Dick Bellamy.
Oh, Dick, yeah.
A figure,
Bill Stein
really has not gotten the credit.
No.
Dick Bellamy and Green Gallery have not gotten the
very self-effacing guy.
But Dick Bellamy, and Bill Stein both loved Los Angeles. They loved to come out here. They loved to mix with the people.
He showed Jones here and Dick Bellamy.
Really?
Yeah.
Green Gallery?
Yeah. Bellamy did a show for Jones. That's how daring he was. And when I come in to see him in the morning at 9 o'clock, he's getting dressed. He lived there.
He lived in
the gallery.
Yeah, he slept on a little blanket.
That's right.
I remember, you talk about the things you own and the things you have and the things you love. Walking into the Green Gallery early on to see Dick on one of my forays, and I walked by a stand with two hamburgers made of plastic. And I was so riveted by it. It just set off some bells, and Dick came up from where he was, and he said, "Klaus Oldenburg," and I said, "I want to buy it." He said, Alfred Barr just did.
Play again, Irving.
Play again.
So let's pick up with Patty. We're talking about a slightly different, slightly later moment, but you and Betty, how it got started and what the model you set up was.
What we did is we formed a corporation with stockholders. But all we did was raise $100,000 in order to open the gallery. But our stockholders were the Wisemans, of course.
Yeah.
And Alfred Esberg.
Esberg, yeah.
And Norman Lear. And then the wife of one of the Fords, who was a friend of Norman Lear's, and she heard that he was investing in this. So she wanted to do it. And there, and I forget the other people, the Coopers. Nate and Bee. And I've forgotten them. Isn't that terrible?
Terrible investment in the gallery, except for buying pieces, maybe the blouses.
Well, they could buy from us, but they only had to invest like $10,000 or $15,000.
And they were silent partners.
You can see things are changing.
They weren't even, they were a corporation. And I had to fill out forms and do meetings and that sort of thing, which got to be a bore. So now I'd like to undo the corporation.
Yeah. But you'd have stockholder meetings every so often.
I have had them. I haven't done it for years.
No.
But it's in the early days.
Early on, I did it like constantly, every year, and send a report to everybody.
Yeah. And did the gallery make money, or did they have to make up the shortfall?
No, they didn't have to make up anything. They were protected for even if we would have been in debt or anything, they wouldn't have been inherited the debt.
All right.
There was some magic way of protecting it. That we had to do.
Well, limited liability of the corporation.
Yeah.
Right.
that's what it is.
That's it.
That's the magic.
But you were telling us a little bit about, which I think built on what Everett was doing, what Irving was doing, is that you and Betty in the early days partnered with especially New York galleries, but you wouldn't just...
But we didn't really partner. We invited certain galleries out and invited the dealer to come as well. And we didn't even pay his way.
And use their space,
And then they would come there and they would meet everybody. Now, Betty was very well known in this town. She worked as Maurice Tuckman's assistant and was kind of internationally known as a collector, having bought a lot of things.
And a unique collection.
Yeah, and she had a wonderful collection.
Very personal. Yeah.
And everybody loved her. Yeah. And then the other people loved me. And I had my experience with Nicholas Wilder only in this town.
Right.
And I knew artists everywhere in Paris, New York, and here. But that was the extent of I didn't have any formal training, as you didn't either, as a dealer in art.
No. My training was in deception.
I'm a good liar.
Very few people have formal training as an artist.
That's true.
Yeah, you can't have that.
Well, you gotta come and call it. The wall of the gallery would say, Morris Lewis from Leo Castelli Gallery.
The announcement would say.
From Andrew Emmerich,
Not Sidney Janis, he wouldn't own him.
He wouldn't know. He was
he would lend us. He was going to do a show with us, too. But I can't remember what.
I'll tell you about this is a little anecdote about Sidney Janis, about in terms of generosity. He was sending me a Gorky drawing show, very nice one. A lot of it came from Gorky's sister. And the plane was coming on a crate, an American Airlines plane, that crashed on takeoff at LaGuardia. It was like catastrophe number 13 for Gorky once again. All gone.
Yeah.
So I called Sidney as soon as I heard from American. All I heard about the freight, and then I heard about the death. A friend of mine, his wife, was on that plane. He was a lawyer in New York. In any event, Cindy calls me back and said, don't feel badly, it's a tragedy, but we will get this show one way or another. And he called, no, these were works of his. And he called the sister of Gorky, and he gets me a whole new show.
Wow.
And ships it in 3 days. And I had a
home on a different airline.
Yes. So that, by the way, don't buy first class tickets. But that's the kind of person he was. And his name wasn't on it. Never asked.
Early on, I went to talk to Sydney, went to the gallery. He had 57th Street Betty kind of on the other side of the hall. And we talked for a minute or two, and I said, I'm terribly sorry, but I have to make a phone call. Do you have a phone available? He said, yeah, he said, it's in the car here. And I get up and I walk in the car. It's a pay phone.
Yeah.
And it's gone. I put a dime in.
Why do you think you made so much money?
They said that about J. Paul Getty, that he had payphones throughout the mansion, so
wow,
the servants couldn't make free phone calls.
Wow. I'm about to do that in my house.
And thanks to those payphones, we have this wonderful center here.
Well,
that's right.
When the director of the Getty Museum here, when J. Paul was still alive, put in a petition for an electric pencil sharpener, he wrote back and said, what's wrong with a knife?
So Stanley, I think we're on to you. Talk about the sort of business model you put together for Gemini, how things got started.
It's funny, just by points, I didn't know what the subject was except the 60s here, and so I was at Gemini yesterday and we were talking, and we said, you know, we were born out of innocence. I mean, it was a strange situation. Elise and I had taken extension courses at Felix Landau, Walter taught one, Shirley taught one, and it enjoyed art, and we had joined the Contemporary Art Council, Modern Contemporary, it was called the Contemporary Art Council, that, I mean, Jim Elliott was good, Jim was fabulous for us, and like one of the first meetings, John Cage was there, so we got that sort of introduction into the art world, and we'd been active at the West Side Jewish Center. I was in the Young Men's Club at Cedar Sinai, and he said, what institutions, Jewish institutions around the city do you want to do? And so this was probably late 50s, very early 60s.
Yeah, you want to talk just a little bit more about that, because that's a forgotten aspect of
what. Well, it's an interesting aspect, because there was this whole scene going there where we had a yearly party that the dealers, I mean auction and sale, that the dealers were very unhappy about. They thought it was taking away. We used to bring in stuff from Baylor, prints and things, and our best story was that we put the good things up on the stage and the prints and things, and some little old lady came up to us and said, that Chago, is he a local boy? But there was a scene there, and then Elise put together some shows.
Yeah,
it was on the first one, I think Michael was in it, Bruce Nauman was in it, and then some lecture series, and I remember the big deal was we were having the showdown between Bob Irwin and Frank Stella, and then it was going to be the showdown at OK Corral, and everyone was there, and Irwin did not challenge Frank. Did not challenge him, so there was this big letdown. This is going to be the fight. Bengston did a brilliant thing where he his lecture was his music he listens to and slides of his studio. He sat there and you saw what his studio was about and him working and what his music he was listening to. That was his lecture.
Terrific.
That was that scene, and then we joined the council and we bought a Joseph Albers for him.
That's right.
And that was probably the first major thing that we bought. And these extension courses that stimulated us, because we took them in poetry and in literature and in theater and music.
I'm not going to interrupt for just one thing, because I think that's another very important thing just to get on the record.
Yeah,
it was a series of extension courses taught through UCL Extension,
yes,
put together by a man named Friedman, which was the head of Extension at that time.
Why don't we come back to this? I think the whole next subject should be the fact that there were no collectors and how you all built a collector.
Okay, so I'll try to move on to general.
Yeah, I can
just, you, again, they just think it shouldn't be lost for me.
No, right.
And then we met, in fact, Larry was the first one we met. We met the artist and it was all over. We loved the artist. We had this little kind of love affair that happened at that moment. And at that time, Sid Felsen, who I'd gone to college with, and he was a CPA, and he'd always been, he was did ceramics, and he'd gone to Chouinard and Otis and Barnsdall, and he did a lot of income tax for some of the artists. He knew more of the local artists, but he had done that, and he kept saying, I want to get out of this, and the guy, oh God, why am I forgetting his name, a very weird guy, who was on La Cienega, who was a friend, and somehow Manny Silverman was a little bit around,
right.
And oh, he said, he wanted to get out of that, and he knew a guy working at Douglas Aircraft, one of the aircraft places, who brought in prints from Byler, and we used to have evenings up there. And one day Sid said, "What do you think about maybe prints? You know, going into that?" Because he wanted to get out of being a CPA. Well, I know a few printers. And Kentaller was one of them. Lisa had gone into art services and was hustling and said, "You need a forklift?" And he said, "No, but the guy in the back may need one," and it was Ken. And so he needed a roller conveyor, and I had some roller conveyors around that, and Ken was a pretty good salesperson. So we worked something out. So this was 1965, so we had a meeting with him. He said, "Yeah," he said, he had done the last living thing, I think, of Giacometti's as a as commission piece for LA County Museum. He was doing commission work, and he had done John Altoon About Women, which was a wonderful thing, with, who was the poet that was it a terrific poet?
Creeley.
Robert Creeley.
Creeley.
Very good. We said, "Well, what do you think?" I know him. He said, "Yeah." He said, "I'm borrowing money from my mother-in-law, and I really don't want to be in the business." So we got together in '65, and we said, "Let's start it. Let's pick out an artist." Well, we were naive, and we went to Edward Hopper, who was living in Boston.
Well, you guys thought the older generation would
be. Yeah, because we thought they're not going to be here. You know, they have a limited time. Let's go to them. So. Edward Hopper, Rothkopf, Newman,
right.
They all said yes, but they weren't really ready. I mean, we'll do it, but we'll get around to it.
Not this minute.
Yeah, so we owned this Albers, and Ken said, "Well, I know Albers." Okay, let's get started. So
Ken didn't know Albers, because Albers landed in New York, and we took him down.
Oh, yeah, but then he had printed him in town.
Right.
He had printed him down. Right. So that's when we got to know him before.
Right.
So so we started in Albers, and we said, okay, as long as it's someone we believe in, we started with that theory. And Sid was still working very part-time at Gemini. It was a very part-time. So we started with this thing about it'll be fun to do, you know, it'll just be a good time. Yeah, they are the very first things. We collated these over our dining room table. We decided several things early. Number one, to do good brochures. Second, I think these sold for $100, and so we said, you know, that's a lot of money, but we took them and they had an art form, because that was, you couldn't understand the critics, but the ads were good. I think Fried was the writing and so on. So, like a Fried and Don Judd and some of those people, they talked to each other a lot. We got started. What did we want at that time? I was thinking of Save the Tiger. They said, "What do you want in a life?" To Jack Lemmon, he says, "One more season, one more good season." So you just started and tried to keep alive.
Mm-hmm.
And the older artists wouldn't do it. And then Bob Rauschenberg, who we had met earlier, and he was connected with Jim Elliott and at the merry-go-round, when Jim was living there. He came out with his roller skating group with he and Alex Hay, because after he won the Venice Biennale.
Right, yeah, we're just right. It was his dance group, the Robert Rockford Dance Company, that performed at the opening of the Los Angeles County Museum in 1965, April 1st. They did a roller drone piece called Pelican, which they were doing in Judson Church. And then they did a piece in the pond.
Yeah.
What was that year? 65.
60, yeah.
First 1965.
Did you call it the, it's the, was the Morse Cunningham
No. See, those two different things. This was the artistic director for this, sets and costumes, and that's what he did first. Yeah. Then he went into this, because after 64, he was very wise, as he is, and just decided he wanted out for a while.
Right.
And he went around with Merce and John, who were really good friends.
And he was part of all of
and Duchamp. That was kind of the group. And so he came out and we met him, and I was in the forklift business, and he said, I have the wings and things, but he needed some steel, so I knew how to do that. So it was a good way to connect with him. And so we did that, and then we were searching, and then we went back to New York, and we said to him, would you work with us? And he, yes. Well, Alvers had been his teacher at Black Mountain. I think that had something to do with it.
Right.
And Alvers later on, Bob did this big profile in New Yorker not too long after.
Did you get Bob before you got Jasper?
Yeah, Bob was first. Bob was first. Right. He was really the turning point in where, because the older guys would said they'd come out, but wouldn't. When they called Albers to ask him his impression of Bob Rauschenberg and Black Mom, Albers said, I had a lot of students, I don't remember. But Bob was lovely about it. He said, I needed the discipline. He said, I used to just dig into pots of cans of paint and smear it on canvas. Well, he said, Albers gave me some discipline. He said he'd come out. So 1967, because it took us all of 66, and we played around. We did something with Ben Sean. Man Ray was living there, so we did something with Man Ray. Right. He came out to that show at LA County in 66, and we said you could live at our house, which was a turning point for us, moving the kids around, having them there.
But it gave a lot of people that I was showing at the same time a major reason for coming to Los Angeles.
During the winter,
when Frank Stella came out, because I had an exhibition in my gallery, he would work in Gemini.
But Frank's was a funny story, because he came out to teach at Irvine, and they wanted him to sign a loyalty oath.
He said, stuff it,
and Barbara took the job. He was married to Barbara. And so she took the job, and he was around, and we knew him, because by then, through Irving, Leo Castelli was also our hero, and we loved those artists, and we'd always make that visit. So Frank was in town, so he was even, I think, before Jasper, and Frank had never done a print. But he said he was willing to learn.
Yeah.
I mean, with Bob and Jasper, they were masters already. Tatiana Grossman was our hero. That was the LA, Well, Bob's, this was typical. He comes out, and he always said, everyone's different. Roy would come out, he knew exactly what he was going to do, and he'd go from 9 to 5. He died way before his time. He was incredible. But Bob would come out and say, I have no idea what I'm going to do. So he's walking on the street, and he sees a little drawing that someone's thrown away, and it's a kid's drawing of a rocket booster. And he said, okay, he calls it Booster and Sound Studies, his series. So he said, I've always wanted to do a self-portrait. Yeah, what kind do you want to do? My skeleton? X-ray. Okay, not a bad idea. So then we start to look around, and it turned out chiropractors had big machines. We didn't know that. So we knew some people through. I was active at Cedars, and a friend of Sydney's was a doctor. And he said, yeah, I can take it, but I got to take it in 3 parts. So we had to do it 3 different stones. And so that was Booster. Maybe the best print we've ever done at Gemini. But it was typical of him, where he just kind of rolled with the stuff going on around.
As opposed to somebody like Frank, and this is really interesting to me, who recapitulates maybe the whole history of lithography. He begins by making lithographs that are about that size.
Yeah.
And completely intimate, kind of totally wrong for the medium.
Yeah.
And Frank, who is as brilliant as can be, learns by doing, and gradually increases his scale, and by doing, learns exactly how to
do it. Bob did it naturally. His intuition is so brilliant.
Look, can you imagine starting with something like this?
Port Arthur, Texas.
This is a Bob Rauschenberg.
Port Arthur, Texas, only he.
It's unheard of. Look at the scale. Look at the audacity. The audacity.
And Tatiana's, he'd done little ones, yep. I believe.
Yep.
But he knew this was Los Angeles, freeway interchanges, yeah. 747s. Yeah. You know, this is where the space was different.
Yeah.
But he started in Fort Arthur, Texas, and National City is where Grossmont High. Henry started along with John Baldessari and Tom Waits.
Whoa! You're a walking pro.
But the other thing that's so fascinating at this time with the giant stone, the whole thing of the self-portrait, but it's so related in two dimensions to the three-dimensional combine that is set here.
Yes.
It's amazing.
Yes.
Well, he's has always been, as much as 3 days ago in awe, Bob, was just one of the true giants of our time. And then once he came out, Jasper said he would come out.
Yes.
And then it kind of fell in line of the people we wanted.
Right.
Said yes.
And
a couple of more Sydney Janus. Elswood Kelly and Oldenburg were at Sydney's.
Right.
But the rest of them were mostly. But we dealt with local artists. We dealt with Sam Francis, Joe Good, Ron Davis, he's still out there, Grand Canyon, Kenny Price, Larry Bell. It was about half and half.
David Hockney
was a local, really, Los Angeles.
You know, one thing I remember, Klaus came out to make some lithographs at Gemini. I can't remember exactly the time. But Patty had just left him.
Yeah. When he first came out, she was part of it.
And I had a show scheduled. And he came into the gallery a week before I was meant to show. He was making lithographs. Came into the gallery, really despondent, and I said, I heard that you and Patty are no longer a team. And he said, that's exactly right. And I said, I can't tell you how sorry I am. He said, well, these things happen. I said, I guess that means no show. And he sat, and I remember he stared at the wall and stared at the wall, and then looked at me and he said, Irving, he said, rent me a sewing machine. And he worked behind the gallery and made a show of soft sculptures all by himself without Patty.
Yeah.
Because most people don't know it, Patty had sewn.
Patty had sewn for it.
Klaus
could sew.
Yeah, he went right to what she was doing. That's interesting. And he always said that out here was soft. So fabrics, and Lincoln fabrics,
exactly.
Where he bought his things.
Exactly.
And New York was the plaster and harder.
He
liked that sculpture was hard and soft, and his ideal was a beanbag ashtray. But then he came up and Disney wouldn't do it.
Scissors.
We
sold them to Linda Turbell.
But he and Patty were together when he came out in one of our more brilliant ads, where they were lying on a press, and it said, Klaus Oldenburg is working here now.
Yeah,
they were both lying there. But they stimulated each other in a very special way.
He does the notes.
Yeah, the Pasadena.
Famous.
Part of it was Pasadena, and the museum. It was really quite naive, the whole thing about just staying alive and doing the things that were fun. And ultimately, it might have to
and being in the right place at the right time.
That's
and
all.
Having the right people.
I'll tell you what else we did.
That's all.
What else we did. In New York, they were doing a lot of, even we always do a 10x10 where each artist did one. We said, work in depth with the artist. You know, it's kind of dumb luck in a way, but we said, let's not do one. Let's work in depth. So we started with the Albers, and then with all the rest of them, we said, we want to do a series with you. We only do maybe three things a year. Now we do maybe five, but we're going to work in depth with you. And no one was really doing that much. Even at Tatiana's, and we loved her. She was the one who gave us all. Yeah, there was Jim Wayne out here who was doing more of the business of art, and they had $1 million tamarind, a Ford
fund
to do it.
And
came from there. Trained it. And curators and printers and things. The artists were important, but not as important there. Tatiana's, it was about the artists.
Jim Wayne is living in Albuquerque now, and she's become a man, finally.
Wayne June.
John Wayne.
But I want to get one quick thing on the record, and Stanley alluded to it. The thing for me at that time that was so incredibly important about Gemini, and Prince, yes, of course, and everything else, But the main thing, and you mentioned it earlier also, this intercourse between the artists of New York and the artists of Los Angeles, that started because they came out here, they spent weeks here, they met everybody, they had a good time with everybody. So that it really was one of the major first steps to bringing Los Angeles to an adolescence, out of a childhood into an adolescence.
Because in retrospect, number one, we had better temperature climate than San Francisco. Yeah. But San Francisco was earlier, like when Ferris started. Like really, the San Francisco artists were the bigger artists at the time.
Yeah, they were.
And it could have gone either way very easily.
It could have gone either way.
Gemini helped do that.
Yes,
that Los Angeles stayed the one. I think it would have anyway, but it didn't hurt.
Yeah, but there were this remarkable generation up in San Francisco. It really was.
Yeah.
Most of them overlooked.
Well, with the Art Institute and all that, they came up to teach.
Yeah.
Rothko was teaching there.
If Hassel Smith had lived in New York, he would have had a career.
Yeah.
The colors are a little muddy.
That's right.
I have a Lobdell in my house. I've got about 200 works hanging up there. I test the hypothesis that rural people have a very good eye because they're so used to looking nature and making something out of what they see. So I bring ranch hands in and